Our God is still on his throne and ruling the affairs of man. Even as he does not change, his truths have not changed. Thankfully, God still has a people which proclaim that old-time religion, setting forth his sovereignty, and the old paths of truth where we can find rest for our souls. Welcome to Word of Sovereign Grace, a ministry of Paradise Primitive Baptist Church in Arlington, Texas. Get your Bible, call your friends, and sit back as we open the King James Scriptures to explore the glorious Word of Sovereign Grace. Here's this week's message.
Once again, I appreciate the opportunity to be in the house of the Lord. I can't think of anywhere else that I would rather be. I ask that you pray for me for what time I stand before you this morning, that the things that are said would bring edification and instruction to you, and that above all, that the name of our Lord Jesus Christ would be exalted and that he would be worshipped this morning. I pray that the Lord would help you to put aside the things in your mind that disturb you, and that you can meditate for a little while on his goodness, his mercy, his love, and his truth. You know, the scripture tells us to buy the truth and sell it not. It seems that some people don't have an understanding of that. It seems like truth is, people are ready to sell truth at the drop of a hat. I believe, if I'm not misunderstanding, what's taking place in our nation today is that Christianity actually is under attack. It has been for some time, and it seems like the jabs, if you will, are accelerating, coming a lot quicker. And it's probably by course of nature, when you have men that are installed in office that care nothing for God, the fruit of that will manifest itself in time. The scripture says when the righteous are in authority, the people rejoice. But when the wicked bear rule, the people mourn. And I think that it is a time to mourn the things that are taking place in our land. I believe they are an affront to the Lord and his truth. But we need to take a stand. We need to continue to stand. And if we've not been standing, we need to stand up. I've been teaching about these things for several years. I'm not claiming to have prophetic knowledge of any of these things, but it's in the book. If you just read the book, you can see these things. So that brings us to a very interesting position that we find ourselves in. What do we do? Romans chapter 13 tells us very clearly that were the powers that be are ordained of God. But I believe there comes a point when the powers that be start telling you to violate the very laws of God, it becomes another matter. I remember in the military, we took an oath to uphold the Constitution and to obey lawful orders. Now, there are lawful orders, and you had to obey those. And if you didn't, you could get in some hot water. But there were also unlawful orders that we were told that we did not have to obey. Maybe we would have been told, if we were in a combat situation and told to shoot some women and children, defenseless people, or something like that. Something that violated statutes like the Geneva Convention. There were statutes to guide our conduct. Well, the same is true in the kingdom of God. We serve God. We have statutes that we're to follow. I mean, if I'm trying to make a comparison of how that being in the military, that we follow lawful orders, we have statutes here. And there was a time after the Lord had gone back to glory and the gospel is beginning to go out to the Jews, went to the Jews first, then later on to the Gentiles. We read about that in Acts chapter 10. But there was a time when the apostles were arrested and they were beaten for preaching the same things that we preach today. And then there was one occasion that they were arrested and they were straightly charged, don't you preach anymore in this man's name, in the name of Jesus. Well, Peter had an answer for that. In Acts chapter 5, verse 29, then Peter and the other apostles, now he wasn't just, we know how Peter in times past was one that would open his mouth and say things that got him in trouble. But now it's just not Peter alone. Now do I need to put the mic on so you can hear?
No, I don't have any hearing aids
today. Okay. I'll go ahead and put this on to help you out a little bit. I've never been accused of being so quiet. So Peter's not standing alone in what's about to be said. They take a position. They thought it. They rejoice in that they were counted worthy to suffer persecution and to be beaten for the name of Jesus Christ. Now that's something that's very rare. I mean, it may be happening overseas where we find that we hear stories about ISIS and all of these radicals and terrorists that are beheading Christians and so on. That may be true. Those people that are being martyred may be rejoicing that they're counted worthy to suffer for Jesus' sake. But here, Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. And I think that's probably where we find ourselves today, that we ought to obey God rather than men. Now, I had already decided some time ago that if someone were to come in here and a gay couple and ask me to marry them, it wasn't going to happen. I'm willing, if need be, to go to jail if that's what it takes. But you see, there's so much that's going on and that's happening. Is that, like I said at the onset, the very gospel itself of the Lord Jesus Christ is under attack. I want to turn over to Galatians chapter 6, and with the idea in mind that we ought to obey God rather than man, keep that in the forefront of your mind. I'm going to go over to Galatians chapter 6 and look at this and pray that the Lord would be my helper to look at this a little bit. Paul says here, he said, brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, we which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. So, today it's politically incorrect to take a position to want to correct anybody. Now, they're labeling that if we point out the fact that someone's a sodomite or someone's doing something, that they're labeling that hate speech. And they're calling these hate crimes. Now, this is all political talk because I've never known a crime that was committed in love. I just never seen one. I think all crimes are probably crimes of hate, or at least crimes of misunderstanding. But they're labeling and they're trying to put us in a position where we are going to be hamstringed to preach the gospel. Now, thank the Lord, we are not a 501c3. And if you don't know what that is, it's where you register with the IRS and you give them authority to come in and tell you what you can and can't speak. Well, that's where the rubber meets the road. And all that was back in the 60s when Lyndon Johnson was doing a lot of things. They set this off. I think he was running for president before he actually... At one time, he was a senator, and they set this up to allow the churches to give their congregants a tax break if they made donations. But the rest of this act read that you can't make any political speech. You couldn't speak against your political enemies. Well, I don't know how many multiplied hundreds of thousands of churches are registered as 501c3s, but there are a bunch of them. We don't answer to anyone but the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the head of the church and He's the Savior of the body. We don't answer to the government. There are supposed to be amendments to the Constitution that protect our religious freedom. There's supposed to be separation of church and state. And we have things happening in this nation now where it seems like those that are in control of the media are controlling the people, and they're pitting everyone against everyone else. It's the divide and conquer. You know, the Lord said a house that's divided against itself cannot stand. And the scary thing about it, you begin to look at how many Republicans and how many Democrats there are. You look back to the election of George Bush and Al Gore, it was almost, this nation is almost equally divided politically speaking. Well, all that, I believe, is by design. And now you have cops against black people, white people against black people, liberals against conservatives, and conservatives against all, you know. It's just, I believe that all this is by design. The enemy knows what he's doing. But having said all that, I believe that the Lord is still on his throne, and God is suffering this to take place for a reason. I don't fully understand it, but I know that it's in the book. He tells us in the latter times, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. And he says that evil men and seducers will wax worse and worse. And the people are indeed being seduced. So we have a situation in our land that is very unique. But God is still on his throne, and I take consolation in that knowledge, and knowing that it could very well be in that the tares are being separated from the wheat, in a manner of speaking. And it may very well come again to a time in this nation where we will have to seal our testimony with our blood. And we may, if you want to get right down to it, that may very well be the case. I don't know. But you have to ask yourself the question, are you willing to die for what you believe? This is the whole idea of worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ should never have been about being social or having, you know, social interaction and being in some kind of special club. It's not. The Lord God is real. He's alive. He's the creator of the heaven and the earth. And he takes very seriously those that he places into his kingdom. We've been translated out of darkness and put into the light. We're in the light of the kingdom of God. And what we do in the kingdom of God is of a very serious nature. It's not just, well, I think I'll become a Christian because, you know, everybody's kind of doing it. It's the end thing to do. Well, we will find out at length who those that really love the Lord. I remember a story that's told. Whether it's true or not, I'm not sure. I suspect that it probably is, but I'll preface it with that caveat that it was during World War II when many churches had to go underground in Germany. And, you know, of course, you know, the World War II was raging and Hitler and all these things, and the church had to go underground. And there's a small group of people that are meeting, 15 or 20 people, and a German soldier busts in, you know, with his weapon. And he says, "Are you ready to die?" And some people got up and ran out. Then he got a little more specific. He says, "Are you willing to die for what you believe?" Had his gun at the ready. And a few more ran out. Then he asked those the last time, he says, those four or five that were left, "Are you willing to die for what you believe?" And they said, "Yes, we're willing to die." And then he put down his gun and said, "I want to worship with you." A people that loved the Lord to such a degree that they were willing to die for what they believed. And are you willing to die for what you believe? Does your belief in the Lord Jesus Christ mean that much to you? Or are we going to get up and shag out? Were they to bust in here right now, the authorities, and pull their weapons on us and threaten to kill us, what would we do? That's just something for us to think about. But here he says, he tells us, brethren, if a man is overtaken in fault, and we oftentimes, we get overtaken with fault and with sin. But he said, if a man's overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness. Now, meekness does not mean weakness. Peter says, be ready to answer any man that asks the reason of the hope that's in you with meekness and with fear. And that's just not with you. That means that if you see, you need to see that in the other individual as well. Because otherwise, if you don't see the meekness and fear, and if it's not on both parties, on the one that that's standing ready to give an answer of the reason, the hope that's within us, and the person that asks, if there's no meekness and fear there, there's not going to be a connection. And what you're going to have is you're going to be casting your pearls before swine, so to speak, and you wind up giving that which is holy to dogs. I'm a firm believer that the Lord always works on both ends. If He would have us to testify or witness to someone, that He will be working with the other individual as well. But here He says, if a man's overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. We need to look and see if we got a beam in our eye before we try to get the speck out of our brother's kind of thing. We need to do that. That's something that we need to do daily, examine ourselves, whether we be in the faith and whether we're walking circumspect, whether we're walking in a way that would not bring reproach on the Lord Jesus Christ and His cause. It's always good to do that before you attempt to help somebody else. But if we're not allowed to point out anyone's faults, and by the way, you know where all this is leading is they're undermining the Word of God, have been for years. They don't want to accept it as authority. They thumb their nose at it because they don't want to be answerable. You see, just like evolution teaches that there's no God. Well, if that's because if there's a God, then people become responsible to Him. But they want to say that there's no God so they can just live any way that they want. That's really what it's about. People don't want to they don't want to have to be responsible or answer to the God that created all things. So they have these fairy tales in their mind that a frog became a prince over billions of years. You know, but people would accept that, but if I told you if a princess kissed a frog and he became a prince like that, well, that's a fairy tale. But if it happens over billions of years, well, it must be true, right? No, it's not. So, but we've got to consider ourselves, and we need to make sure that we're walking in a way that's pleasing to the Lord. If we want to help someone, we need to do that. But they're trying to make it where we can't. It's hate. You must hate someone if you point out their faults. You know what? I hear it all the time. The reason that I tell God's people the things that this book talks about is not because I hate them. It's because I love them. I'm seeking their wealth. I want to see them prosper in the things of God. I want to see them growing in knowledge and in grace. But you know what? People don't like this book again because it makes them responsible and it shows them their depravity. It shows them that they're rotten, no good, lousy, scumbag sinners. Okay, that's in today's vernacular. But it shows them that they're no good and they're not worthy of the least of God's blessings. They don't want to see that. That's not a feel-good thing. But you know what? It's good for us. When the light of God shines in our hearts and shows us our depravity, and thank God we don't see the full depth of it, but He shows us enough to get us our attention. And you know, the Lord could do that right now to everyone in this nation if He was pleased to do it. But He's obviously right now not pleased to do that. Holy Spirit conviction could fall on it just like it did on the day of Pentecost when those men were pricked in their hearts when they heard that they had crucified the Lord of glory. They were pricked in their hearts and said, men and brethren, what shall we do? Unlike some Jews at one time that when they heard the preaching of Paul, they were cut to the heart and they began to gnash on Paul with their teeth. That just means they were gnashing with teeth, meaning they were cussing. They were cursing. They were cursing Paul. But some people are cut to the heart. No conviction. No Holy Spirit conviction. And I know of a doubt that if what I've experienced, if other people of God have experienced that, that if that were to fall on people that are now doing the things that they're doing, they would turn like Paul did on the road to Damascus, and they would be changed. And when they got up out of the dirt, they said, "Lord, what will you have me to do?" But that's what it's going to take. That's what it's going to take, repentance and the Holy Spirit falling on people on an individual level and people repenting on an individual level. And then this nation can turn. But that's... And why hasn't God done that? Well, I don't know. I'm not God. I don't know why. But I know that He's able to do it. I know that in my own testimony that He stopped my wild career because I was heading down a path to death and destruction when He turned me around. And if He can do that to me, He can do it. And you, He can do it to anyone. Why hasn't He done it? I've often wondered, and when I think about all these things that have transpired by degrees, little by little. Remember, you hear me talk about the rock and roll and how it's progressed to what it is today and to this head-banging, awful... Just like I remember the cartoons I watched when I was a kid. Tom and Jerry, the Jetsons, you know. But even then, in Tom and Jerry, look at the violence that was in that. Now it's evolved and what you've got is Dungeons and Dragons and all this occult stuff that's labeled as cartoons, entertainment for children. Little by little, I mean over the years, it's progressed to what it is today. And it's harmful. It's harmful to our children. Where was the church back in the 60s? That's what I've asked. You know, I know that it's not the mission of the church to change the world. I kind of have to remind myself of that from time to time. Because John chapter 14 says the world cannot receive the Spirit of truth. But what the church is to do is to be a light, be that city that's set on a hill, to be a light and a beacon of light to those of God's people that are in the world, to call them to come out of the world and come into the church. But I don't think it's the mission of the church to reform the world. Because the world never will receive the Spirit of truth. It can't receive it. But God says to sanctify and to set ourselves apart. But where was the church back in the 60s? I often wonder, should they have been standing up? Should they have been saying... I don't know. I was a young child back then, and I don't know. Maybe we were still running far to the right from the Armenians back then that we didn't pay attention to what was going on. I don't know. But I trust that some of God's faithful men stood up and were vocal about those things that were taking place. In the midst of all, taking prayer out of school, you know, making it lawful to have abortions, and you had the civil rights movement, all these things going on. I don't know where the church was. I don't know what they're saying. All I know today is that I'm taking a stand against this stuff, that it's wrong, and I'm going to stand up and I'm going to believe what God says, that those things that they are saying are right and good, that they're sin and they're an offense to God, and I'm going to stand up against it as long as I have breath. Now, here's something that I find very, very offensive. The very day that the Supreme Court makes this decision, that at the very time that that's happening, you have our president standing behind a pulpit in a church singing Amazing Grace. And I want to tell you, I don't think that man knows what grace is. Because that very night at his house, what does he do? He lights up the White House as a rainbow. See, there's another affront to God, because that rainbow is a token of God's covenant. That's just like giving God the bird. That's exactly what that is. And you know, the Bible tells us, and we find here in this very chapter that we're at, that what a man sows, he shall also reap. You're right, David. What a man sows, that shall he also reap. God is not mocked. And you think These people might think that they've gotten by with something. Oh, no, they haven't. No, 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 no. Not you or I either. We never get by with anything. Peter talks about judgment begin. Where does judgment begin? It begins in the house of God. And if judgment begins in the house of God, where will the righteous be scarcely saved? And what's going to happen to those that don't obey the gospel? Judgment begins right here in the house of God. But no, they're not going to get by with anything. I want to get down here. Verse 6. And he talks about bearing one another's burdens, and absolutely we need to be doing that. Praying for one another, caring for one another. Verse 6, he says, "Let him that is taught in the word communicate unto him that teacheth in all good things. Be not deceived." You see, the devil is what? The father of lies. And he works by deception. Now, there may come a point when all this comes to a head that he might stand up and tell us plainly what he wants to do. But until he gets to that point, he's going to lie, and he works by deception. And he wants God's people to think, well, you know, God doesn't care about any of this. You know, where's God? You know, God's letting this happen, God, you know, or there is no God. He says, "Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting." So, you're going to reap what you sow. And the question becomes, will I reap what you sow, Brother Aaron? Or will someone else reap what I've been doing? No, every man will reap what he sows. So, you look at and try to look at this on a larger scale, but what happens when you have a king that's doing things to a nation? Well, you think, look at what happened to King David. Because of what he did, he murdered Uriah the Hittite so he could have his wife. But the Lord said his sin was forgiven. But because of what David had done, he said the sword would not depart from his house all the days. And so what that means, if you got a king that's at war, guess what? Guess where our sons and daughters are? They're in that war. Yeah, we'll probably reap some consequences. There will probably be some consequences that will trickle down to us. I think about sowing and reaping. I think about Jacob. Jacob met Esau one time. And Esau was hungry and faint. And Jacob had some lentils or some pottage or something on the campfire. And Esau was hungry, he was about to faint. Jacob said, "Sell me your birthright. Swear to me you'll sell me your birthright." You know, the birthright of the firstborn. And he sold it to him. Then later on, when their father, when Isaac said, "I don't know how much longer I'm going to be around. I want to bless Esau." He says, "Go out and make me some savory meat such as I love so I can bless you." And Rachel heard it. And she said, told Jacob, he says, "I'm going to make some meat and I want you to go in and get that blessing." So he wound up stealing the blessing or deceiving his father and taking the blessing that he was going to give to Esau. And we find later on, it was a little later, that he went to live with Laban, that he loved, I get Rebecca and Rachel mixed up sometimes, but he wanted Laban's daughter, was it Rachel? And he said, "I'll serve 7 years for her." And he did. He served 7 years. But come the wedding night, You know, he consummated a marriage, and he woke up in the morning, and it was Leah. It wasn't the one that he served for. And he complained to Laban. He says, Laban said, it's not right for us to bypass the firstborn. So what you see in that Jacob is reaping what he had sowed there in that deception. And by the way, that's his name, is supplanter or deceiver. And that's what Esau said. Is he not rightly named Jacob? Because he's a supplanter and deceiver. But anyway, he reaped what he sowed. David also reaped what he sowed. And that the law talked about if you stole a lamb, that you'd have to restore fourfold. Well, David lost four of his sons because of what he did to Uriah the Hittite. Remember Nathan come and talked about the one that had the a traveler came by and he had one ewe lamb and all this, and he took from another man's flock. David pronounced that man must die. And Nathan told him, thou art the man. But David lost four sons on account of that. He reaped what he sowed. And correct, Sister Deborah, vengeance belongs to God. He says, vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. That's not our business. We shouldn't be in that business, ever. I don't care what it is that's done. You know, God is not mocked. It's the saying in among the younger generation is, what goes around comes around. But that's saying the same thing, we'll reap what we sow. And I really don't like using the word karma. Karma comes from another religion, from a false religion. It's basically the same principle, but I want to avoid using that. I hope that you avoid using that also. It's called the law of reciprocity. You reap what you sow. So, when we think about how this nation is being preserved, he says, you're the salt of the earth. What is that? Well, salt has a preserving power. Salt and light. We're supposed to be salt and light. And we look back and we see how that Abraham took it upon himself to speak to the Lord when the Lord told him that he was getting ready to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. He said, will you destroy it if there's 50 righteous? And then 40, 30, 20, 10. And it turns out that four were let out. Three made it all the way out. And the rest were destroyed. I believe that God has some righteous people in this land. Not those that stand in their own righteousness. No, not in self-righteousness. But those that have the imputed righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is, I believe, is the only thing that is keeping God from raining down fire out of heaven on those people that want to take it upon themselves to call evil good and good evil. And that's what they're doing. That's exactly what they're doing. They're putting light for darkness and darkness for light. The Lord says, woe unto them that do that. Ezekiel tells us in one place when God was getting ready to destroy a city, he told the angels, he said, go through the city and mark the foreheads of all that cry out against the abominations that are taking place. Put a mark on their forehead. Then he said, go through. Then after that, he said, go through and destroy everyone. He says, and start at my sanctuary. What? That's where Peter draws from when he says, judgment begins at the house of God. He's drawing from Ezekiel. But he said, you put a mark on the foreheads of those that cry out and that mourn on account of the abominations. And if we're not crying out, if we're not standing up and we're not being vocal to say that these things are wrong in the sight of God, and they're an offense unto God, and they're in violation of His Word, we may regret it someday. We need to stand up. We need to speak up. And we need to cry out. And I don't care what they call it. I call it truth. They can call it hate speech all they want. I don't care. Stand up. There's a saying that if you don't stand for something, you fall for everything. It's time to stand up. I say, let's take back the rainbow. It doesn't belong to them. God never said they could have it. They're trying to hijack it. That's also... I don't want to be around when that particular sin is judged. I don't want to be anywhere near that if God give me grace. Because I don't think the Lord's going to take that very lightly. But I think a lot of the people that do that, they don't have an understanding. They just think it's cool, you know, all these different colors. But it's a token. And look, that is a token that God has said, I will never again destroy the earth by flood. Now, I've got some pictures in my phone of some rainbows. And I've got a picture of a beautiful rainbow. And one of the things that you can see in that rainbow is above the rainbow, the water is very dense. The sky is much darker than underneath that rainbow. That rainbow's holding back the flood. It's a beautiful picture. Every time I look at it, I'm reminded of God's promise that what He said in this book is true. You know, another thing that He says in this book is that the Lord Jesus Christ is coming back in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and obey not the gospel. Now, some would call it, well, that's terrorist talk. It's in God's book. We preach all of it. Not just the parts that we want. You know, we could come here every Sunday, and if you wanted me to, I could speak from Romans chapter 8 every Sunday. Would you like that? Some places do that, by the way. Or Ephesians 2, 8, 9 every Sunday. Well, there's more in this book. Now, and like I said earlier, we're called to even love our enemies. And I know people that are in that way. Now, I don't condemn them, but I condemn the sin. And we need to pray for them. Because, you know, Paul says in one place, and such were some of ye. Such were, you know, here's the deal. If an adulterer or a fornicator or a drunkard or a thief or a liar, you can be a member of the church. It says you, but the thing is, you can't keep living that way. Because such were some of ye. We were all in times past, we were in some sin. But when we come into the church, we've got to repent, we've got to put that away. I welcome anybody that wants to come in here and sit and listen. But you can't be a member of the church and live in rebellion to God. It just, that's one of the reasons all the denominations out in the world are so much turmoil and they're so messed up is because, hey, you know, do whatever you want. Yeah, you can be a member of our church. That's not what this Bible teaches. We come into the kingdom of God. He says, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. That don't mean it's far off. That don't mean it's 2,000 years later. It's here right now. Come into the kingdom. Press into the kingdom. But you got to repent. You remember those that came to John the Baptist? And they wanted to be baptized. He says, and he didn't do it either, by the way, on this particular case. He says, repent and bring forth fruit meet for repentance. I know it's not been so long ago that when people would join the old Baptist church, before they took a vote, they wanted to hear an experience of grace from that individual. Now, I know we've become lax about that. And an experience doesn't have to be a long, drawn-out. I think sometimes if it's said in the right spirit and sincerity just to say that I love the Lord, that's sufficient. But you used to hear a lot of extracted experiences of people told that how they were convicted of their sin how that they didn't deserve the least of God's mercies and blessings, how that they know that God would be just to send them to hell, yet and they love the Lord. That's fruit meet for repentance. But nowadays, a lot of people are just bypassing that. We've got a little bit of an uproar by one of our ministers that lives in Ohio. He thinks that we're becoming pedo-Baptist again, that we're baptizing infants, youngsters. I don't necessarily agree with him. I think that if a person is young enough to know that they love the Lord, what this lends to, if you get to the idea, well, we shouldn't baptize them because they're not a certain age, and you start preaching the age of accountability. So, and that doesn't wash either. I think if you're old enough to know that you love the Lord and that you're expected to serve, then you're old enough. Because which of you that have been in the church maybe 50, 60 years, you understand everything about baptism? And if you answer me yes, you may be stretching it a little bit, because I don't think any of us do. You say, well, I'll wait till I understand everything about baptism before I join the church. You never will. You never will. But it's simply a profession of faith, a testimony that you believe that God raised Jesus from the dead. There's more to it. But if you think that, I'll wait till I'm better. You know, I'll wait till I got too much sin in my life. I'll wait. You know that song that we sing, if you tarry until you're better, you will never come at all. Some say, I'll just put it off until then. Until I, you know, get all things worked out, everything straightened up. You never will. You never will come. No. If you know that you love the Lord, and you understand that it's a sacrifice to join the church, I think that's sufficient. Now, I don't believe in baptizing infants. Absolutely not. I think when you do that, you rob them of believer's baptism. See, there's joy and there's consolation in believing and putting on Christ. We need to know that when we're baptized, we put on Christ. I know. You know, I was thinking about all this stuff, and what do I say to you? What do I say to the people? What do they need? What kind of instruction? And I just simply believe that we need to fall in line with Peter, and that it's better that we better obey God than man, because when it comes to an unlawful order. And if there's consequences for that, then there's just consequences. But I'm not saying to become unruly. I'm not saying to rebel against the authorities. Because there's a lot of things we need to continue to obey the speed limit signs. We need to continue to obey the laws, the just and right laws that are on the book. But when it comes down to it, if somebody was going to force you to abort your child, or force, you know, they've like I say, I already took the stand that no one's going to force me to marry anybody. By the way, did you know, if someone would come in here and says, I want you to marry us, then I would say, you want a biblical marriage? And then they would say, yes. I said, okay, show me where it's in there. Did you know that it's not in there for, he said, what God has brought together, let no man put asunder. But it's not in there for a couple to come to the church and have a minister stand before them and solemnize their vows. It's not in this book. It's tradition, but it's not in here. So I'll ask them, do you want a biblical wedding? Of course they'll say yes. Because they won't know. And I say, well, show it to me in here and then we'll do it. But it's not in there. our governor, and brothers and sisters, pray for me, because I've normally, you know me, that I don't talk a lot about politicians. But if we were a 501c3, we'd really be in trouble right now. But our governor, thank God, has passed a law. It's called the Pastors Protection Act. That the law will back me up if someone wanted to try to sue me or force me to marry a gay couple. Now, that's backbone. That man's got some backbone. I don't agree with everything that every politician does. And most of them, they are. They're just politicians. But we do have some leaders. We do have some. Thank God for this man that he stood up to do that. We need to be praying for our leaders. We need leaders. We don't need politicians. A politician could go through this room, every one of us have a different position on it, and that politician will tell you, every one of you, that he'd give you what you wanted. That's what a politician will do. But a leader won't do that. A leader will stand up for what's right. And that's what we need to be praying, that God give us leaders, righteous men that would stand up against the minority. And by the way, I believe that it is a minority. Gays are not in the majority. Where's the silent majority? We've been silent for too long. We need to stand up. But you got a few that control the media. And there's a saying, those that control the media control the people. You may or may not agree with that. And here's something else I'm going to say. With all this that's going on, I think it would behoove us, since these things are accelerating, like this church shooting and all this political storm going on around us, it would behoove us to probably to not go to large public gatherings right now. I think that would be... I want to recommend that to you. It's up to you what you want to do. But I think that the atmosphere is prime. Whoever's behind all this, whether you believe that it's ISIS or Al-Qaeda or the government or whoever you think it is, or just rogue people around there that are on drugs and just have a gun collection, whoever's behind it, well, the devil's ultimately behind it, whoever you think that's behind it, I think that the atmosphere is prime, that we need to be careful that we get into large assemblies and pray that God protect us here. Because, you know, in the eyes of the world, we're nobody anyway. And I could care less what they think. But forgive me if I've said too much about politics. Because I was really, I just didn't know what to say to you, except what I've said. And if I've offended you, that's not my intent. If I've said something in ignorance, I pray you cast the mantle of charity over my ignorance. But the good news is God's still in control. And the, like I said, the people that are in control of the media, they're painting a picture, okay? And it's not what they're painting. The reality is not what they're painting exactly. Now, there's some half-truths mixed in with it. But don't believe what you see on TV. Investigate for yourself. Pray. The saying is, don't believe anything you hear and only half of what you see. Because time's short. I've thought about this. The devil knows that he has a short time. He says, "Woe unto the inhabitants of the earth, for the devil is coming down having great wrath, for he knows that he has but a short time." And I thought about this. He knows something about the timing. Because otherwise, why would he work so slowly? If that's over the last 50, 60 years, just by small degree, he's got to know something about timing. I don't know what it is. But there's something there that he knows the timing about. Because the Lord said he does. He knows. He says he knows he has a short time. Whether that's 2,000 years or what, I don't know. But I do know this. that the Lord's going to come back at the appointed time. And he's going to wrap all this up. And he's going to take us home. By the way, Betty, I don't know if you noticed, you got up right after... I've been praying for my wife because when she lost her brother. And Brother Aaron doesn't know that what he said in his prayer was the exact same thing I said at your brother's funeral. And I don't know if you heard that or not, but I wanted to point that out to you. I got it. That's confirmation from the Lord. When I said, it's not goodbye, I'll see you later, Brother Aaron, that's exactly what I was telling those people. And that's confirmation from the Lord for me, at least for me, and I hope it is for you. It wasn't goodbye. And if any of you, if you pass during the week, it's not goodbye. We'll just see you later. We'll see you later. We're going to catch up to you. But the Lord's coming back. He's coming back at the appointed time. He's going to wrap this all up. We're pilgrims and strangers here. The world is not our home. And we might find ourselves with the same testimony that Moses had, that he had rather suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Pray for me, if you would, when at a throne of grace, that God would help me to get my head wrapped around His Word. I know I've been scattered, and I know I've been talking politics this morning, and I normally don't do that. I pray that God comforts you and that He give you grace, that you have to know that He's got all things in control. It's not out of hand. The Lord knows what He's doing. I thank you all for your good attention. As we stand and sing a suitable hymn, if one or more has a desire to unite with his body, this will be your opportunity.
Word of Sovereign Grace, a ministry of Paradise Primitive Baptist Church in Arlington, Texas. Paradise Primitive Baptist Church is located at 5300 Mansfield Road in Arlington, Texas. Services begin at 10:30 each Sunday morning. Plan to come and worship with us. To find out more about Paradise Primitive Baptist Church, visit www.paradisepbc.org. Be sure to visit our website for articles, video, and audio sermons, as well as biblical answers to your questions. Thanks for watching, and be sure to join us again next week. May God richly bless you.